第二个要跟各位刚刚说的是全球脑，意思就是说我们必须在全世界的尺度里面，从地方到这个中央到全球各个政府以及所有的人都变成一种共同的努力，去限制我们对于地球资源的使用。第二个是我们想要问的，如果少数人没有参加没有办法解决问题，多数人如何参与？第二个演讲呢，跟各位安排的是说，也许我们应该创造出来一种新的人类。那这是什么意思？我们现在的人类是被教育的方法，包括现在我们的教育系统，其实都是18世纪以后工业时代之后才产生的教育方式。那么很多人开始在思考，是不是这样子的教育方式让它变成越来越没有办法应付现在地球所面对的问题。我昨天跟一位朋友在吃中饭的时候聊天，他说他告诉他的女儿，我们这一代都因为不会吃东西，所以都把自己吃了很多不健康的食物。那么我们吃了很多不健康的食物呢，我们再来想办法说，那我要减肥，我要排毒，我要做什么。他说他告诉他的女儿说，你如果让你的儿子们女儿们，也就是他自己的孙子们，从生出来呢，就不要教他去吃那些东西，就根本不给他吃那些东西，他以后就不需要去减肥排毒。懂我意思吗？意思就是说，你把它教坏了，然后你才想要办法要把它矫正。我们现在不是都这样吗？就是吃的不对，所以吃的过胖去减肥，吃的不对就吃了一大堆毒素，然后你才去排毒。那么如果不是这样的话，那就是一种新的教育，新的教育会教出新的人类。我们来看看这是什么意思。接下来的这几张图片请各位用心看一下，边看边思考。有人知道这是什么地方吗？你喜欢吗？还不错。这是教室。如果这是我们的教室，你看它下面不是有座位吗？如果这个是我们的教室，竹屋、竹桌、竹椅，甚至还有竹子的黑板。这个黑板是一片一片竹子是编起来，看到没有？然后把它涂成黑色，这个也是一个竹片，弯起来它变成放笔的地方。校园就在田的中间，梦境一样的行政中心。假如就教室就在天堂，大概就是长这样。天堂也有厕所。童年往事是竹影，小径的头尾都是芭蕉，你可以看到它的道路都没有水泥，都是小石头去铺起来的。是欢喜学习，是独立思考。你可以看见这些小孩子的眼神跟他的态度，是交换意见，是倾听。同学来自世界各地，学习手写，也学习电脑，学习做冰淇淋，也学习做披萨，那是他们的午饭，自己做的。学习握住一条蛇，也学习轻轻地握住蚱蜢。学习观察青蛙，不是解剖青蛙；合作表演，不是比赛。天堂也有夜晚。竹子可以造桥， 当然也可以盖篮球场。你要知道这是一个人哦，所以这竹子是盖一个好大好大的房子，它是一个篮球场。走出竹桥，进入社会，这样的童年会有什么样的未来？会有什么样子的梦想？我最想问的是，会有什么样子的梦想？我们现在的教育系统，让我们没有办法梦想，根本就不敢梦想，因为你没有在一个鼓励你梦想的环境中间受到孕育。当你是种子的时候，你的环境不是让你去梦想的，你的环境是让你要曲线向上，向上。那所以是这个人，这个人呢很有趣 ，John Hardy。他小时候被诊断为阅读障碍，所以他每一天要去学校，他都在哭，他不想去，可是他还是被强迫要送到学校去。所以他说他上学上得非常非常的痛苦，虽然他现在最爱做的事情叫做阅读，他小时候叫做阅读障碍。他说他25岁的时候他决定逃走，逃到哪里去呢？他逃到巴厘岛去，他就在巴厘岛住下来，然后在那里认识了他的太太。他跟他太太在巴厘岛就创办了一家珠宝公司，赚了很多钱。有一天他太太，没有几年前，他太太带他去看了一场电影，他说那一场电影毁了他的一生。那一场电影就是 Al Gore 的那一部电影，把他送上去和平奖，顺便也毁了他的一生。他把他的珠宝公司卖掉，他就去创办了刚刚那所学校。那他觉得教育是我们过去200年失败的最重要的原因，因为我们没有把人教成人，而是我们把人教成机器，活的机器。他不是一个现在他在教的那些小孩的样子，所以他说，他讲给我们听的就是说 My Green School Dream， 他的学校就叫做 Green School， 你上网去看看得到 greenschool.org。 这个我已经刚刚跟各位说过了，他2007年开始盖这个学校，现在只不过2010年，那个学校好像已经盖了好久。那我们来听听他的演讲。
I grew up in a very small village in Canada, and I'm an undiagnosed dyslexic. I had a really hard time in school. In fact, my mother told me eventually that I was the little kid in the village who cried all the way to school. I ran away. I left when I was 25 years old to go to Bali.And there I met my incredible wife, Cynthia, and together over 20 years, we built an amazing jewelry business. It was a fairy tale. And then we retired. Then she took me to see a film that I really didn't want to see. It ruined my life. The Inconvenient Truth and Mr. Gore. I have 4 kids.And even if part of what he says is true, they're not going to have the life that I had. And I decided at that moment that I would spend the rest of my life doing whatever I could to improve their possibilities. So here's the world, and here we are in Bali. It's a tiny little island, 60 miles by 90 miles. It has an intact Hindu culture. Cynthia and I were there. We had had a wonderful life there, and we decided to do something unusual. We decided to give back locally. And here it is. It's called the Green School. I know it doesn't look like a school, but it is something we decided to do, and it is extremely, extremely green. The classrooms have no walls. The teacher is writing on a bamboo blackboard. The desks are not square. At Green School, the children are smiling. An unusual thing for school, especially for me. And we practice holism. And for me, it's just the idea that if this little girl graduates as a whole person, chances are she'll demand a whole world to live on. Our children spend 181 days going to school in a box. The people that built my school also built the prison and the insane asylum out of the same materials. So if this gentleman had have had a holistic education, would he be sitting there? Would he have had more possibilities in his life? The classrooms have natural light. They're beautiful. They're bamboo. The breeze passes through them. And when the natural breeze isn't enough, the kids deploy bubbles, but not the kind of bubbles you know. These bubbles are made from natural cotton and rubber from the rubber tree. So we basically turned the box into a bubble. And these kids know that painless climate control may not be part of their future. We pay the bill at the end of the month, but the people that are really going to pay the bill are our grandchildren. We have to teach the kids that the world is not indestructible. These kids did a little graffiti on their desks, and then they signed up for two extra courses. The first one was called sanding, and the second one was called rewaxing. But since that happened, they own those desks. They know they can control their world. We're on the grid, we're not proud of it, but an amazing alternative energy company in Paris is taking us off the grid with solar. And this thing is the second vortex to be built in the world. In a 2.5 meter drop on our river, when the turbine drops in, it will produce 8,000 watts of electricity day and night. And you know what these are. There's nowhere to flush. And as long as we're taking our waste and mixing it with a huge amount of water, you're all really smart, just do the math. How many people times how much water? There isn't enough water. These are compost toilets. And nobody at the school wanted to know about them, especially the principal. And they work. People use them. People are okay. It's something you should think about doing. Not many things didn't work. The beautiful canvas and rubber skylights got eaten by the sun in 6 months. We had to replace them with recyclable plastic. The teachers dragged giant PVC whiteboards into the classrooms. So we had some good ideas. We took old automobile windshields, put paper behind them, and created the first alternative to the whiteboard. Green School sits in South Central Bali. And it's on 20 acres of rolling garden. There's an amazing river traveling through it, and you can see there how we managed to get across the river. I met a father the other day. He looked a little crazed. I said, "Welcome to Green School." He said, "I've been on an airplane for 24 hours. I asked him, "Why?" He said, "I had a dream once about a green school. And I saw a picture of this green school. I got on an airplane. In August, I'm bringing my sons." This was a great thing. But more than that, people are building green houses around Green School so their kids can walk to school on the paths. And people are bringing their green industries, hopefully their green restaurants, to the green school. It's becoming a community. It's becoming a green model. We had to look at everything. No petrochemicals in the pavement. No pavement. These are volcanic stones laid by hand. There are no sidewalks. The sidewalks are gravel. They flood when it rains, but they're green. This is the school buffalo. He's planning to eat that fence for dinner. All the fences at Green School are green. And when the kindergarten kids recently moved their gate, they found out the fence was made out of tapioca. They took the tapioca roots up to the kitchen, sliced them thinly, and made delicious chips. Landscaping. We managed to keep the garden that was there running right up to the edge of each of the classrooms. We dropped them gently in. We made space for these guys, who are Bali's last black pigs. And the school cow is trying to figure out how to replace the lawnmower on the playing field. These young ladies are living in a rice culture, but they know something that few people know in a rice culture. They know how to plant organic rice, they know how to look after it, they know how to harvest, and they know how to cook it. They're part of the rice cycle, and these skills will be valuable for them in their future. This young man is picking organic vegetables. We feed 400 people lunch every day. And it's not a normal lunch, there's no gas. Local Balinese women cook the food on sawdust burners using secrets that only their grandmothers know. The food is incredible. Green School is a place of pioneers, local and global. And it's a kind of microcosm of a globalized world. The kids are from 25 countries. When I see them together, I know that they're working out how to live in the future. Green School is going into its third year with 160 children. It's a school where you do learn reading, one of my favorites, writing, I was bad at it, arithmetic. But you also learn other things. You learn bamboo building. You practice ancient Balinese arts. This is called mud wrestling in the rice fields. The kids love it. The mothers aren't quite convinced. We've done a lot of outrageous things in our lives, and we said, okay, local, what does local mean? Local means that 20% of the population of the school has to be Balinese. And this was a really big commitment, and we were right. And people are coming forward from all over the world to support the Balinese Scholarship Fund because these kids will be Bali's next green leaders. The teachers are as diverse as the student body, and the amazing thing is that volunteers are popping up. A man came from Java with a new kind of organic agriculture. A woman came from Africa with music. And together, these volunteers and the teachers are deeply committed to creating a new generation of global green leaders. The Green School Effect, we don't know what it is. We need someone to come and study it. But what's happening, our learning different kids, dyslexic, we've renamed them prolexic, are doing really well in these beautiful, beautiful classrooms. And all the kids are thriving. And how did we do all this? On giant grass. It's bamboo. It comes out of the ground like a train. It grows as high as a coconut tree in 2 months. And 3 years later, it can be harvested to build buildings like this. It's as strong and dense as teak, and it will hold up any roof. When the architects came, they brought us these things. And you've probably seen things like this. The yellow box was called the administration complex. We squashed it, we rethought it, but mainly we renamed it the heart of school. And that changed everything forever. It's a double helix. It has administrators in it and many, many other things. And the problem of building it, when the Balinese workers saw long reams of plans, they looked at them and said, what's this? So we built big models. We had them engineered by the engineers. And Balinese carpenters like this measured them with their bamboo rulers, selected the bamboo, and built the buildings using age-old techniques, mostly by hand. It was chaos. And the Balinese carpenters want to be as modern as we do, so they used metal scaffolding to build the bamboo building. And when the scaffolding came down, we realized that we had a cathedral to green, and a cathedral to green education. The heart of school has 7 kilometers of bamboo in it. From the time the foundations were finished in 3 months, it had roofs and floors. It may not be the biggest bamboo building in the world, but many people believe that it's the most beautiful. Is this doable in your community? We believe it is. Green School is a model we built for the world. It's a model we built for Bali. And you just have to follow these simple, simple rules. Be local, let the environment lead, and think about how your grandchildren might build. So, Mr. Gore, thank you. You ruined my life, but you gave me an incredible future. And if you're interested in being involved in finishing Green School and building the next 50 around the world, please come and see us. Thank you.
是吧？这个是一个对于学建筑的人来说很重要的启示。什么启示呢？告诉我们，建筑真正重要的是它能够做些什么事情，而不是他长成什么样子。各位如果看到他请了一位建筑师来设计的时候给他的第一个草模型，像不像我们做的样子？像，像极了。那为什么我们都做出一样的东西呢？因为我们没有真正的去思考学校是什么意思。我们想到的只是学校是一个房子，而不是想到学校是什么。如果你想的是学校是什么，而不是想的学校是什么房子，那么很可能我们造出来的就是不一样的东西。所以这个 Green School 它现在短短的时间，除了那100多个学生以外，你如果到它的网站去看，它也接受公司行号去那里做这个公司的培训。那他们有一些竹子的小屋，或者是人多的话，他们就去帐篷，住帐篷，那变成营队，他接受在那里这个公司的这个培训。他也接受十几岁的年轻小孩被父母送去那里做1个礼拜到2个礼拜的这个 camp， 所以我相信这一类的教育模式，这一类的建筑会越来越多的让我们去了解我们在工业化以后的许许多多的思考，事实上已经到了一个可以改变的时候，而且有人已经把那个模型做出来告诉我们说，他想把人类变成另外一种样子，绝对不要回去19世纪、20世纪训练小孩子的样子。所以那个是新的人类。第三个，新的专业。我们刚刚谈到建筑师 看到他的那个基地，替他设计的一个模型的学校的概念，其实就是一些建筑的形貌。那么接下来的这一位，我们以前介绍过他的房子，他是一位建筑师，但是他今天在 TED 上面要跟我们分享的是专业也要改变。他在说的就是说，建筑师最重要的就是去思考他需要做一件什么事情来让眼前的这个找他设计建筑物的人的工作变成有意义，而不是只是去盖一个漂亮的房子，或者是只是去作为装饰。许多的建筑师现在变成是名字有用，因为名字就可以把房子卖出去，就可以变成一种品牌。但是更重要的是，我们要把那样子的一个专业所产生出来的产品变成什么。所以不只是建筑师，当然还有各种的专业，律师、教师，大家需要做什么样子的重新思考，才能够产生一种新的专业。这种新的专业，它就是变成是一个集体的智慧，真正的能够去参与解决世界的问题。他今天要说的题目是 Building a theater， 盖一个剧院 that remakes itself， 就是它可以自己重组，重新变成任何它应该要变的样子。举例来说，我们这一间教室如果是他的那个思考的话，应该这个地板有时候可以是平的，有时候可以是飞起来的，有时候可以是怎么样子。那么还不只是这样，说不定是有更多的可能性应该去思考。所以我替他整理一句话，就是说专业不是装饰品，专业是专业，专业不是拿来做装饰，更不是拿来盖章用。所以他虽然盖了一个 Seattle Central Library， 我想各位我们在上课的时候都介绍过，那个已经被称为是一个 masterpiece， 在现代建筑的这个里头已经大家都觉得是一个非常好的建筑。但是他最不希望人家叫他的就是叫他作为一个 master， 就是叫他一个大师。他觉得最重要的，他是每一个工作他都希望能够真正的去思考他要在里头扮演什么角色。所以我们来看看他的影片。一栋非常有意思的房子，
I'm going to speak to you today about architectural agency. But what I mean by that is it's time for architecture to do things again, not just represent things. This is a construction helmet that I received 2 years ago at the groundbreaking of the largest project I and my firm have ever been involved in. I was thrilled to get it. I was thrilled to be the only person standing on stage with a shiny silver helmet. I thought it represented the importance of the architect. I stayed thrilled until I got home, threw the helmet onto my bed, fell down onto my bed, and realized inside there was an inscription. Now, I think that this is a great metaphor for the state of our architecture and architects today. We are for decorative purposes only. Now, who do we have to blame? We can only blame ourselves. Over the last 50 years, the design and construction industry has gotten much more complex and has gotten much more litigious.And we architects are cowards. And so as we have faced liability, we have stepped back and back. And unfortunately, where there is liability, guess what there is? Power. So eventually, we have found ourselves in a totally marginalized position way over here. Now, what did we do? We're cowards, but we're smart cowards. And so we redefined this marginalized position as the place of architecture, and we announced, hey, architecture, it's over here. In this autonomous language, we're going to cede control of processes. And we are going to do something that was horrible for the profession. We actually created an artificial schism between creation and execution, as if you could actually create without knowing how to execute, and as if you could actually execute without knowing how to create. Now, something else happened, and that's that we began to sell the world that architecture was created by individuals creating genius sketches, and that the incredible amount of effort to deliver those sketches for years and years and years is not only something to be derided, but we would merely write it off as merely execution. Now, I'd argue that that is as absurd as stating that 30 minutes of copulation is the creative act, and 9 months of gestation, and God forbid, 24 hours of child labor is merely execution. So what do we architects need to do? We need to stitch back creation and execution, and we need to start authoring processes again instead of authoring objects. Now, if we do this, I believe we can go back 50 years and start re-injecting agency, social engineering, back into architecture. Now, there are all kinds of things that we architects need to learn how to do, like managing contracts, learning how to write contracts, understanding procurement processes, understanding the time value of money and cost estimation.
稍微停一下下。刚刚他在讲的那一段，设计跟执行，我们许多的设计者在设计的时候，由于不知道这件事情到底怎么样会被执行出来，所以他在设计的时候是在无知的状态底下去想象他怎么被执行。我就讲常常我说的故事，我在东海大学念书的时候，经常在下课的时候，只要一有空，我每一堂下课，那个时候我们都是走文理大道，我就从文理大道走下去，赶快跑到图书馆，跑到图书馆里面去，把那个月的杂志，几本建筑杂志拿出来翻，从第一页，我一定翻到最后一页封底，从封面翻到封底，我才会结束。这一节没看完，下一节赶快跑去再看。我做什么呢？我是不是一页一页好好去读呢？不是，我只看照片。我看照片做什么呢？我只看了照片，然后问我自己一句话。如果叫我盖，我知不知道这个东西怎么盖起来？99%的答案，我的答案是不知道。我看着一张桌子，这个怎么做起来？哪一个先定？哪一个先弄上去？我甚至不晓得它是用螺丝锁上去，还是用榫头做上去，因为我看不出来，所以没有答案。与其说没有答案，不如说不知道答案。我根本不知道这个东西怎么做起来，所以几年的大学生活当中，几乎我在每一节下课的时候都给我一个刺激，叫做我不知道这个东西怎么做起来，因为不断地告诉我自己我不知道这个东西怎么做起来，所以在几年的大学中间，虽然设计的成绩很好，但是我自己很明白，我什么也不知道，因为我根本不会盖。所以就算是会画很漂亮的房子，我也知道，像我现在常常跟我的年轻朋友说，你们在画漫画，因为只要人家拿了你的图不知道怎么盖起来，就是漫画。那个跟一个会画漫画的人画一个漂亮房子有什么很大的两样呢？没有很大的两样。所以他刚刚的那一句话就是说，作为建筑师，他必须不只要告诉人家说我要做一个什么目的，也就是说我要盖一个什么房子，他还要告诉人家我要怎么盖这一栋房子。如果你不知道怎么盖这栋房子，那就是别人要去做怎么盖这栋房子的责任。那么有责任的人才是有权利的人，所以你说不出来，你就没有权利讲话。所以你到最后，建筑师就变成是一个装饰品。什么装饰品呢？第一， 法令说你要盖章才可以去申请执照，所以你叫做一个盖章的。第二，责任是法令说你要负责安全的责任，可是业主敢不敢让你负责呢？他不太敢，因为他知道你也不知道那个东西到底安不安全，或者是等等。甚至讲到更仔细，那个窗子的细节怎么做呢？如果你去看我们现在台湾的所有的，不要讲所有的，很多数的房子为什么窗都漏水，因为你请那个画细部设计的那位建筑师事务所的同仁来说，你那细部设计怎么来的？他说厂商给的。如果是他自己画的，问过他你到工地看过他怎么做起来吗？没有。所以这个就是很大很大的问题。他在说的意思就是说，一个要真正把房子好好做起来的人，一定要好好的去知道这个东西是怎么被做起来的，而不是只会做一个样子，不知道后面是怎么做起来的。那这句话我个人觉得非常的重要，所以才要停下来跟大家特别再解释一次。
But I'm going to reduce this to the beginning of the process into three very pedantic statements. The first is, take core positions with your client. I know it's shocking, right? Architecture would actually say that. The second position is actually take positions. Take joint positions with your client. This is a moment in which you as the architect and your client can begin to inject vision and agency, but it has to be done together. And then only after this is done, are you allowed to do this? Begin to put forward architectural manifestations that manifest those positions. And both owner and architect alike are empowered to critique those manifestations based on the positions that you've taken. Now, I believe that one really amazing thing will happen if you do this. I like to call it the lost art of productively losing control. You do not know what the end result is, but I promise you, with enough brain power and enough passion and enough commitment, you will arrive at conclusions that will transcend convention and will simply be something that you could not have initially or individually conceived of. All right, now I'm going to reduce all this to a series of simple dumb sketches. This is the modus operandi that we have today. We roll 120-foot Spartan, i.e. our vision, up to our client's gates of Troy. And we don't understand why they won't let us in, right? Well, how about instead of doing that, we roll up to the gates something they want? Now, this is a little bit of a dangerous metaphor because, of course, we all know that inside of the Trojan horse were a bunch of people with spears. So we can change the metaphor. Let's call the Trojan horse the vessel by which you get through the gates, get through the constraints of a project, at which point you and your client have the ability to start considering what you're going to put inside that vessel, the agency, the vision. And if you do that, you do that responsibly, I believe that instead of delivering Spartans, you can deliver maidens. And if I could summarize that all up into one single sketch, it would be this. If we are so good at our craft, shouldn't we be able to conceive of an architectural manifestation that slides seamlessly through the project's and the client's constraints? Now, with that in mind, I'm going to show a project that's very dear to many people in this room. Well, maybe not the dear, but certainly very close to many of the people in this room. And that's a project that is just about to open next week, the new home for the Dallas Theater Center, the D. and Charles Wiley Theater. And I'm going to present it on the same terms, issue, position, and architectural manifestation. Now, the first issue that we faced was that the Dallas Theater Center had a notoriety that was beyond what you would expect of someplace outside of the triumvirate of New York, Chicago, and Seattle. Now, this had to do with the ambitions of the leadership. But it also had to do with something rather unusual, and that was this horrible little building that they'd been performing in. Why was this horrible little building so important to their renown and their innovation? Because they could do whatever they wanted to this building. When you're on Broadway, you cannot tear the proscenium down. This building, when an artistic director wanted to do a cherry orchard and wanted people to come out of a well on the stage, they brought a backhoe in and they simply dug the hole. Well, that's exciting. And you can start to get the best artistic directors, scenic designers, and actors from around the country to come to perform here because you can do things you can't do elsewhere. So the first position we took was, hey, we as architects had better not show up and do a pristine building that doesn't engender the same freedoms that this old dilapidated shed provided the company. The second issue is a nuance of the first, and that's that the company and the building was multiform. That meant that they were able to perform, as long as they had labor, be able to go between proscenium, thrust, flat floor, arena, traverse, you name it. All they needed was labor. Well, something happened. In fact, something happened to all institutions around the world. It started to become hard to raise operational costs, operational budgets. So they stopped having inexpensive labor. And eventually, they had to freeze their organization into something called a bastardized thrustinium. So the second position we took is that the freedoms that we provided, the ability to move between stage configurations, had better be able to be done without relying on operational costs, right, affordably. The architectural manifestation was frankly just dumb. It was to take all the things that are known as front of house and back of house and redefine them as above house and below house. First blush, you think, hey, it's crazy. What could you possibly gain? We created what we like to call Superfly. Now, Superfly, the concept is you take all the freedoms you normally associate with the fly tower and you smear them across fly tower and auditorium. Suddenly, the artistic director can move between different stage and audience configurations. And because that fly tower's ability to pick up all the pristine elements, suddenly the rest of the environment can be provisional. And you can drill, cut, nail, screw, paint, and replace with a minimum of cost. But there was a third advantage that we got by doing this move that was unexpected. And that was that it freed up the perimeter of the auditorium in a most unusual way. And that provided the artistic director suddenly the ability to define suspension of disbelief. So the building affords artistic directors the freedom to conceive of almost any kind of activity underneath this floating object, but also to challenge the notion of suspension of disbelief, such that in the last act of Macbeth, if he or she wants you to associate the parable that you're seeing with Dallas, with your real life, he or she can do so. Now, in order to do this, we and the clients had to do something fairly remarkable. In fact, it really was the clients who had to do it. They had to make a decision based on the positions we took to redefine the budget being from 2/3 capital A architecture and 1/3 infrastructure to actually the inverse, 2/3 infrastructure and 1/3 capital A architecture. That's a lot for a client to commit to before you actually see the fruition of the concept. But based on the positions, they took the educated leap of faith to do so. And effectively, we created what we like to call a theater machine. Now, that theater machine has the ability to move between a whole series of configurations at the push of a button and a few stagehands in a short amount of time. But it also has the potential to not only provide multi-form, but multi-processional sequences, meaning the artistic director doesn't necessarily need to go through our lobby. One of the things that we learned when we visited various theaters is they hate us architects. Because they say the first thing they have to do, the first 5 minutes of any show, is they have to get our architecture out of the mind of their patron. Well, now there are potentials of this building to allow the artistic director to actually move into the building without using our architecture. So in fact, there's the building, there's what we call the draw. You're going down into our lobby, go through the lobby with our own little dangly bits, whether you like them or not, up through the stair that leads you into the auditorium. But there's also the potential to allow people to move directly from the outside, in this case, suggesting a kind of Wagnerian entrance, into the interior of the auditorium. And here's the fruition of that in actuality. These are the two large pivoting doors that allow people to move directly from the outside in or from the inside out, performers or audience alike. Now, imagine what that could be. I have to say, honestly, this is not something yet the building can do because it takes too long. But imagine the freedoms if you could take this further, that in fact, you could consider a Wagnerian entry, a first act in thrust, an intermission in Greek, a second act in arena, and you leave through our lobby with dangly bits. Now that, I would say, is architecture performing. It is taking the hand of the architect to actually remove the hand of the architect in favor of the hand of the artistic director. I'll go through the three basic configurations. This is the flat floor configuration. You notice that there's no proscenium. The balconies have been raised up. There are no seats. The floor in the auditorium is flat. The first configuration is easy to understand. The balconies come down. You see that the orchestra begins to have a rake that's frontal towards the end stage, and the seats come in. The third configuration is a little harder to understand. Here you see that the balconies actually have to move out of the way in order to bring a thrust into the space. And some of the seats need to actually change their direction and change the rake to allow that to happen. And I'll do it again so you can see it. There you see it's the side balconies for the proscenium. And there it is in the thrust configuration. In order to do that, again, we needed a client who was willing to take educational risks. And they told us one important thing: you shall not beta test. Meaning nothing that we do can we be the first ones to do it. But they were willing for us to apply technologies from other areas that already had fail-safe mechanisms to this building. And the solution in terms of the balconies was to use something that we all know as a scoreboard lift. Now, if you were to take a scoreboard and drop it on dirt and whiskey, that would be bad. If you were not able to take the scoreboard out of the arena and be able to do the ice capades the next night, that would also be bad. And so this technology already had all the fail-safe mechanisms and allowed the theater and our client to actually do this with confidence that they would be able to change over the configurations at will. The second technology that we applied was actually using things that you know from the stage side of an opera house. And in this case, what we're doing is we're taking the orchestra floor, lifting it up, spinning it, changing the rake, taking it back to flat floor, changing the rake again. In essence, you can begin to define rakes and viewing angles of people in the orchestra seating at will. Right here you see the chairs being spun around to go from proscenium or end stage to thrust configuration. The proscenium also, as far as we know, this is the first building in the world in which the proscenium can entirely fly out of the space. Here you see the various acoustic baffles as well as the flying mechanisms and catwalks over the auditorium. And ultimately, up in the fly tower, the scene sets that allow the transformations to occur. Now, as I said, all that was in service of creating a flexible yet affordable configuration. But we got this other benefit, and that was the ability of the perimeter to suddenly engage Dallas on the outside. Here you see the building in its current state with the blinds closed. This is a trompe l'oeil. Actually, this is not a curtain. These are vinyl blinds that are integrated into the windows themselves, again with fail-safe mechanisms, that can be lifted such that you can completely demystify, if you chose, the operations of the theater going on behind, rehearsals and so forth, but you also have the ability to allow the audience to see Dallas, to perform with Dallas as the backdrop of your performance. Now, if I'll take you through, this is an early concept sketch, take you through kind of the mixture of all these things together. Effectively, you would have something like this. You would be allowed to bring objects or performers into the performing chamber. Aida, there are elephants, you can bring the elephants in. You would be able to expose the auditorium to Dallas or vice versa, Dallas to the auditorium. You'd be able to open portions in order to change the procession, allow people to come in and out for an intermission or to enter for the beginning or the end of a performance. As I said, all the balconies can move, but they can also disappear completely. The proscenium can fly. You can bring large objects into the chamber itself. But most convincingly, when we had to confront the idea of changing costs from architecture to infrastructure, is something that's represented by this. And again, this is not all the flexibilities that the building is actually built, but at least suggests the ideas. This building has the ability in short order to go back to a flat floor organization such that they can rent it out. Now, if there's anyone here from American Airlines, please consider doing your Christmas party here. That allows the company to raise operational budgets without having to compete with other venues with much larger auditoriums. That's an enormous benefit. So the theater company has the ability to do totally hermetic, light-controlled, sound-controlled, great acoustics, great intimacy, Shakespeare, but can also do Beckett with the skyline of Dallas sitting behind it. Here it is in a flat floor configuration. The theater's been going through its kind of paces. Here it is in an end stage configuration. It's actually beautiful. There was a rock band. We stood outside trying to see if the acoustics work, and you could see the guys doing this. You couldn't hear them. It was very unusual. And here it is in a thrust configuration. And last but not least, you see this already has the ability to create events in order to generate operational budgets to overcome the building, in fact, performing to allow the company to overcome their biggest problem. I'm going to show you a brief time-lapse. As I said, this can be done with only two people and with a minimum amount of time. This is the first time that actually the changeover was done, and so there's literally thousands of people because everyone's excited and wanted to be a part of it. So in a way, try to disregard all the thousands of ants running around and think of it be done with just a few people. Again, just a couple people are required. I promise. Et voilà. So just in conclusion, a few shots. This is the AT&T Performing Arts Center's D and Charles Wiley Theater. There it is at night. And last but not least, the entire AT&T Performing Arts Center. You can see the Winspear Opera House on the right and the D and Charles Wiley Theater on the left. And to remind you that here is an example in which architecture actually did something. But we got to that conclusion without understanding where we were going. What we knew were a series of issues that the company and the client was confronted with, and we took positions with them, and it was through those positions that we began to take architectural manifestations. And we arrived at a conclusion that none of us, literally none of us, could ever have conceived of initially or individually. Thank you.
Today, 我们大概看到了面对世界新的变化，很大的问题，我们有哪一些机会可以解决？我们的第一个是希望用全球脑来解决。我们花了一点点时间跟各位解释什么叫做全球脑，什么叫做人类的脑跟所有的人脑结合的时候跟地球的关系。 我希望各位对于那一段能够真正的深入去思考，它的来龙去脉，以便能够真正了解这样子的问题如何思考。第二个是一个更进一步的，是为了下一代、下下一代、再下一代着想，我们必须要去彻底的改变我们的教育系统，我们的教育系统。 必须要把它变成交出来一个人，这个人是可以变成是一个完整的人，而不是一个每一个人都是一个小螺丝钉那样子的看法的人。那当他变成是一个完整的人的时候，他要去跟人家合作的时候，他是用一个完整的人跟一个完整的人去要求一个完整的世界，这样子的一个观念去面对世界。 那么，所以世界就不容易变成破碎。那么第三个就是说，当我们必须要去服务这个社会，变成是一个专业者的时候，也要有新的这个专业的态度。所以，新专业、新人类，还有全球脑。